Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Hey, guys, thanks for joining me. It's Tuesday again, and it's Vinny's Drum Behind the Kit show. Behind the kit is actually, this is a door. Right there. There's a door. Because when I record in here, I like to lean back. So I'll do something. I'll record to a song, and then I'll lean back when I'm listening. But it's too far away. I had to move the drums up, so now I can't lean back anymore. So anyway, hope you guys are well. I know my head's cut off a little bit. That's okay. It's still there, you know. And Taco Tuesday, and tomorrow is Lala's birthday. So we missed it by a day. And we had a good week over here. And what'd we do? Yesterday, we went to get Lala shoes at this really nice store. It's not a just a warehouse kind of thing. It's actually people that know feet, know what they're doing. And who winds up buying shoes? Me. You know, so because what's happening, I don't know if this is happening to any other drummers. It probably is. But I'm one bass drum, right? So I'm always cranking the right foot. I'm very heavy with the right foot. Left foot just, it's kind of on vacation all the time. He just goes with me, opens the hi-hat once in a while. You know? He opens it, closes it. So my right foot takes a beating. I mean, I've been playing many, many, many years. And, you know, what's happening is my foot's kind of going this way. So she checked me out. And it's like a bunion thing, you know, it's going this way. I used to get that when I used to play like this. See, in between these two fingers? I used to play like that. Carmine showed me. He plays like that. And he showed me that. And I went, oh, that's interesting. So if your hand's getting a little bit tight, tension, you know, with the regular grip, match grip, you can switch your right hand to this. And eventually you can develop, you know, some control. I haven't played like that in a long time, and I can feel when I play, there's no callus there, there's no nothing there protecting it. I could feel the stick, you know, hitting my finger, my bone and stuff. So it takes a while to build up a callus. But I noticed that I was playing like that for a while. It was kind of like a security blanket. Like if I went up to play and I'm playing, then I go, you know what, I'm just going to take it easy and go like this and hold the stick this way. You can use your fingers. Those are fingers. So I noticed that this finger was starting to curve, you know. It was like this because the stick's in between. And people that ask me directions or something, they go, where's the bathroom? I'm pointing straight ahead, and then they're going this way. because my finger's crooked. So I stopped doing that. I stopped doing it because I was doing a clinic, actually, for GoDPS Sawtooth Chromacast at the studio they have in Thousand Oaks. And everything was cool. It was about a half an hour before I'm going on, and I'm twirling the stick, which I don't really twirl the stick that much. And all of a sudden, my finger went, ow, and it hurt. So I had to go on and play regular. Match grip. So I did that, and I weaned off of this because I thought, this can't be good for your finger. So I think the same thing with the foot. This foot has taken a beating for 50 years. I'm looking for a new foot, so if anybody knows where to get one. And Trumpy! So, you know, what I had to do now was I went there, and she was very, very knowledgeable. Her name was Muna. Right? Really cool. She told me all this stuff I can do and stretches, you know, and she pointed me to some really good sneakers. We call them sneakers in New York. You call them running shoes. You call them, I don't know what they call them out. I'm in California. Probably call them avocado shoes or something. But I hear that. She gave me, pointed me for some cool shoes. They're actually New Balance, and they're a little heavier than I'm used to. Okay, there we go. And so I'm trying to play with them today. And you know what? They absorb the shock. So that's a good thing. They're a little wider on the tip. So sometimes you have a problem with getting your foot on that foot pedal. I kind of play about 2 inches from the end of the pedal that's on the top, and I play with the heel up. See? So these are comfortable, but that's a lot of vibration going on in your bones, you know, especially when I crank it. So these shoes working good. They're working good. I don't feel the vibration so much, which is good. And there's an insole in that makes me walk a little better. So I kind of go to the left now. So she was really cool. So that's so I wound up spending a whole bunch of money on shoes and accessories in there. And then it was Lala's birthday tomorrow, so I bought her some cool boots so she can come on tour with Last in Line and sell the merch. So we're going to announce dates for the Last in Line tour. We got about 20-something, maybe 25 shows or something like that. 2025 right now. Goes all the way through the end of this November, and there might be a couple in December. So we're going to post that with the record company we have now, Ear Music, so it's actually coordinated for once. And on Thursday. And Thursday we will put up the VIPs because we get emails all the time about, when's the VIPs coming? You guys doing VIPs there? You guys doing VIPs here? So, yes, we're doing VIPs on old shows. There's a couple of shows where we're playing with the band Zebra on the East Coast. So we'll have to coordinate that because we're not in charge and we like people to come down to our sound check. So it might be a little earlier for the New York shows with Zebra. I don't think I know those guys. They had that hit song, Tell Me What You Want. Ending. So that's going to be posted on Thursday, and looking forward to that and all the VIPs and everybody that's going to come down and meet us. We usually do you come down and you see a sound check, play a couple songs for you, and then we do signings, and then we do some photos. It's really cool. It's only $1, too. No, I'm kidding. Only kidding. That reminded me of something. When you go play at, you know, we're playing these clubs and small theaters and stuff, we're using the house sound man. So it's always got to be aware, like the end of the song, I always go like this with the bass drum. Bow. You know, so there's that bass drum. It's not very hard. Fills up the bottom end, you know, with the band. And then whatever happens after that. So what happens is a lot of sound guys like to gate the drums. I hate the gates. Sometimes you need them because my drums, these are sawtooth drums, and there's no muffling on them. Little bit in the bass drums, that little Evans pillow. And a lot of times I got a big monitor with a subwoofer, and it tends to feed back a little bit. Like you hear those. So that's when a gate will help that. A gate actually opens when you hit it, like, you know, it's then it closes so it doesn't ring. You know, but it makes the drums dead. So I start with no gates. But that's a good way to, if you do this kind of thing with the bass drums lighter, you have to mention it. If you do this and you don't hear anything in the monitor, you got to tell them, open the gate. Open the gate! So that's my little technique for the gates. Open the gates. And again, thanks to Sawtooth Drums. These are the hickory drums, the higher end drums. This is all hickory, 6 plies of hickory. 10, 12, 13, 14, 16, and 18. Great drums, 24 by 14 bass drum. I love 24 bass drums. And these are fantastic sounding drums. Solid steel lugs, die cast hoops. Fantastic. So if you're in this mood, in the market for a new drum set, you could check it out. And they're available, obviously, on Sawtooth. And they have other kits, cheaper kits, which I used before, and they're fantastic. On these drums here, the Evans heads, G2s on all the toms, and a heavy weight on the snare drum. So, what was I getting at? Hi, Lala.
Hello.
It's your birthday tomorrow.
I know.
Oh, my God.
Oh, no.
You guys ask questions. She'll read them to me because I can't see them.
Nope.
And I'll answer them shortly. Yeah, so Sawtooth has also Sawtooth drums. Have a big sale going on throughout the summer. It's 40% off. I mean, that's incredible. And they make drums, guitars, basses, anything Sawtooth. It's 40% off. There's a code that's probably popped up on the comments area. And that's a really big deal, you know. And if you want a snare drum or you want accessories, sandwich, whatever, you know. Got to have a fan when I play. So what I do a lot of is syncopation beats. And what is syncopation? Syncopation is more like broken up. Like instead of this book I'm going to show you, right? And with the beats, it's not, this is a straight beat, right? Syncopation would be more. The rolls weren't syncopation. Syncopation roll would be more like this. It's got that broken up feel. So I want to show you this book. This is a relic, man. This is from 1968 when I first started taking drum lessons. Check out this book. Look at the price, $250. Syncopation for the Modern Drummer by Ted Reed. It's got tape on it, the old Brooklyn Freezer tape. Mother would go to the butcher and this is Freezer tape. When you went to the butcher back then, they had plastic and all this styrofoam stuff. Wrapped in paper, wax paper with some tape on it, Freezer tape. So it's all over the place. This thing's ripped. And this guy, Ted Reed, actually was Carmine and I's teacher's teacher. His name is Ted Reed. Our teacher, his name was Dick Bennett. Rest in peace. He passed. And his teacher was this guy, you know. And this book, what's cool about it is my first day of drum lesson. I was playing before this. Look at that ripped page. That's scotch tape, right? So my first drum lesson was October 12th, coming up, 1968. First page. Say. And this book, you know, starts off, the first page is like this. It's so easy. That's the first line. Second line. Rest. Rest, 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 rest. That's the third line. That's syncopation, the very beginning of it. So you could see here that my whole lesson was two pages. There's the first page, and then the second page had the exercises, which means it had everything from the first page, but it changes quicker. So that's syncopation, and then it builds up to, like, when I was taking lessons, I couldn't wait to get to this page. You know, it took a while, but check it out. This is the big page. Look at this. That page. That was the page to get to. Like, whoa, it's got everything. And it's got Freezer tape, too, looking right in the middle there. But the funny thing is when you read these things, I mean, this was written, God knows, in the, what's it say? Oh, I need my glasses. I can't put my glasses on this show. What's that going to look like? Anyway, they call it the dance drummer needs to play more syncopation, and there's not that many syncopation books back then about syncopation. So this is still a classic book. Actually, I got it on the music stand. There's another copy, which is newer. This one was $2.50. My lessons were $5 a week. I looked this up. $2.50 in 68 was $20. I'm like, what? It's equal to $20. I'm like, wow. My parents could afford that? That's insane. I think, I don't know how they afforded it, because this book is full of Freezer tape, and we probably had to buy a lot of Freezer tape. And look at this. It's ripped on the back and all that stuff. So anyway, this is a great book. But I came across it in the closet, and I thought, oh, I might want to show that, you know? So syncopation. The only book I know off the top of my head that could teach you beats like that is Carmine's book he wrote, the first book, Realistic Rock. And that starts off like this book. Yeah. Then it goes to... And then eventually it'll start... So that's how you get to throw on all these accents and stuff. It's called syncopation. Check out Carmine's book if you really want to learn some of this stuff, or you play it by ear, you know? If you can tell, Bonzo did a lot of this stuff too. You know, he didn't just play. You know, it's all syncopated. All right. So anyway, that's that, and Lala's birthday is tomorrow. She was supposed to have the drum solo ready. No. The only thing I heard was this thing. That's what I heard her doing this morning. What is that? She said it's the accents. 16th notes with accents. 20 and the 2. And then she put the foot with it. On the 1E. 1E and the 2E and the 1E and the 2E and the 1E. And then she started kind of coming up with other ones like. Man, you got to show me that. Must be those new boots. The new boots. Okay, so do we have a couple of questions?
Yes, we do.
And again, Sawtooth, 40% off. Check it out. And this is all Sawtooth stuff. And the hardware is Chromacast, which is the sister company or the mother company. And they make the hardware. That's what this foot pedal is. It's a Sawtooth pedal. Very fast pedal. Okay, I gotta stop playing. See, I like the way it sounds in these headphones. I wish I could take this sound everywhere I go. Sometimes I go somewhere and it's dead. You know, it sounds like pillows. I hate that. All right, let's take the first question.
Are those drums hickory?
These drums are 6 plies of hickory. No filler. There's no filler meat inside these drums in each of the plies. It's hickory, hickory, hickory. 6 times. And the finish is, this is a kind of dark brown, chocolatey, chocolate cake pudding Hershey syrup. Finish. I swear to God, it is. And they sound great. So it's not a wrap. And it also comes in the blonde color, which is this. That's a blonde snare drum. I like this particular snare drum, so I use this one. And, yes, it is. So check them out. Yeah, sound great. They sound good on here, and I use them for recording. I use them on tour. Love it. Okay, next question.
Is your snare tip forward?
What?
Is your snare tip forward? Forward.
No, it's not.
It kind of looks like it from the
angle. No, it's the camera.
Yeah.
But you know what's funny that you should mention that is on Saturdays, Saturday morning, I like getting up early, and they show an old movie, and it's the Blondie series. It's not Blondie the band. This is like in the 40s, you know? And it's Blondie and Dagwood. They were in the comic strips and all that. And in this particular one on Saturday, Dagwood played the drums. And you look at the snare drum, and it was like tilted like this. I don't know if can you see that. Well, if I turn to the side, it's tilted like this. Weird, man, you know, because everybody back then played traditional. You know? So when the snare is tilted like that, you can get the accents because of the hands position on your left hand. And wow, and I was looking at an old Gene Krupa book, and the same thing. Look at the snare drum. You know, it's just tilted like this. Like, wow, how weird is that? And but I never play like this. I only play like this. I can't control the stick very well. So I only play like that when I'm sitting on the couch or the chair with a drum pad. For some reason, it's comfortable to do. But this snare drum's, I like it completely level, which is hard to do. See, this one's a little bit tilting forward, but it might have loosened up slightly underneath. But I like it leveled, and that, the reason why is so I can get these accents. I like a lot of those accents come out, so that's the way you can get to the rim shot. Okay, next question.
Jace broke two sticks.
Jace. What happened?
He broke two sticks and got a blister.
You should call 911. And if that doesn't work, call 922. That's for drummers. You broke two sticks, dude?
Yeah, and a blister.
Blister?
Oh, my gosh.
Where's that stick I was just playing? This one. Look at this stick I started the show with, and then all of a sudden it opened up. You see? That's going to break soon. This piece. Yeah. Once you lose a piece of wood that big, see how big that is? Look. Now you got less wood up here. And if you're on the snare, it's going to sound a little lighter, different when you start, you know, losing the chunk of wood. But you can't play like this. You'd be playing.
Oh, shit.
I can still use this. That's using the other side, but it's hard to play that way. But anyway, Jay, congratulations. I like that. But you got to build up. You got to get calluses. Blisters are terrible. I used to get blisters when I first started playing, and man, they hurt and all that. And that's supposed to turn into a callus. And that's what I got here on my hands in certain places. And that protects your skin, you know? So congratulations, but you're doing good. You're young and you're kicking butt. I see your stuff online. And hello to everybody else, too, Paul. And is Heidi on?
Yes, she's on.
Heidi. Heidi. I got to go get a blood sugar test. Soon. Charlie, the man, he's coming. We're playing right across the street from his house in Huntington, New York in November.
Yep.
With Last in Line. He just said that, so I said, well, you know what that means. Party at Charlie's house. What time should we be there, Charlie?
Woo-hoo.
So, okay, next question.
Do you still have your Singerlin kit from Holy Diver?
Slingerlin.
I don't say it right.
You know, I have maybe one or two drums from that kit. Years ago, stupid me, call me stupid, I thought, you know what? This stuff's taking up room. And I sold most of that kit to the kid across the street for cheap. He wanted to play drums. I went, well, I'll get rid of this, you know. not thinking that one day this kit that was played on Holy Diver is going to be kind of part of rock history, because that album became very famous, you know. So I don't have much of that left, you know. And the kit I had with Heaven and Hell, the last tour we did, the giant kit, which tore my shoulders out and had to get surgery, I had 21 pieces. It was an amazing kit, beautiful kit. And about 5 years ago, I got a broker called me and said, a museum in Germany wants to buy that kit and put it in the rock museum. I went, oh, damn, what a great place for that kit, because it's in my garage, you know. So we actually accepted the offer, and then I had one of my techs come down, him, me, and Lala, and I had a big poster of the kit, and we tried to put it together. So it was so many. These are the drums on the sides. I had one here, one here, one here, one here, one in the back, one in the back. I mean, it was so many drums. And we couldn't figure out what stands went for where, and because I wanted to put the kit together and number everything, you know, because I never put it together. My tech, Andre, from Germany, he put it together every night, poor him, 21 drums. And it was perfect. He took such good care of them. They were in great shape. Actually, they looked new. So that went in a museum in Germany. But the other kit, man, stupid me. Shouldn't have. I got the bass drum. The bass drum was from the Mob Rules. It's in the other room. And it's a Ludwig Maple. And I do have that, you know. Sometimes I'll put it up one time, play, get a sound check with it. So the only thing with that drum is the legs are really like from, when was that, the early 80s? 80? Yeah. And they don't hold very well. Like these drums, like monster legs on them and oversized wing nuts, and things have changed. Same thing with that syncopation book. You don't need freezer tape anymore. Okay, next question.
What is your opinion on the Sabian B8X cymbals if you can't afford the AAs or AAX?
I don't think I'm that familiar with all that stuff. What is it?
B8X or something?
BAX, okay. Yeah, I never really tried those, so I'm not sure. The thing that I like about cymbals, these double A's are the loudest. Listen how long that rings. So these are very, very loud cymbals, great tone. Some of the other ones are a little thinner. The Bs, I think, are a little thinner, and they don't last as long. But it depends what you're playing, you know. I mean, the stuff I play is all heavy and loud and stuff, so these are perfect for me. But if you can't afford these, then, yeah, find something else that you like, you know. Test the sound. And I always go with one that's higher over here. This is an 18. This is a 20. And I like 20 rides. I used to have a 21, but it's so big, it's hard to control. And these are 14-inch hats, which are pretty fast. Sabian, double A. So you can get a lot of stuff out of them. But I don't have them open very much. I usually open them about a finger's width, you know, so quick. So, but check it out. See what you like, you know. You know, check it out. Where are you going to go? There used to be a lot of mom-and-pop music stores, you know. Now you can't hear them on the Internet unless some guy's going, well, this is the 16-inch B that has a 16 megahertz flux capacitor and will ring for approximately 7 seconds, and then he hits it. You can't tell by that. I guess you got to find a store. Check him out. Okay, another question, Lala.
Another question. Does your drum throne seat swivel or is it set tight?
Good question. Who asked that?
I don't have it written down. I'll have to look.
Okay. No, it swivels. This swivels, this swivels. Reason being, I like to move it around. I like to move around. I play. I go over here. I go over to these toms. I'm kind of moving with the seed a little bit too, you know? And my thing is, like, even the snare, you see how easy I lifted it off. I don't even tighten the stand down, like, really tight on the snare. Or if it's one tom on the stand, a snare stand, I don't do that tight either. That's what I used in Europe on some of the tours with Last in Line because it was a rent-a-kit. What happens is when you tighten the arms on the snare stand, it deadens the drum. This drum's kind of floating on the stand. See, I can move it. I can take it off. I can put it on, right? So it's got its natural ring. Same thing with the tom over there. A lot of guys don't know. You tighten that drum really tight. I mean, the stand really tight. It's not going to ring so as much. Maybe sound like that. The K is shorter. So things to mess with, you know. And this symbol here, I always like to have it tighter, see? Listen to the, like, you know, these are free flowing. This one's a little tighter. So. See, my seat just went like that. Perfect. Okay, another question.
Everybody's asking about Lala's drum solo.
Oh,
well, we'll just have to see. I think pretty soon I'm going to have to do that. And then the other question that everybody wants to know is Vinny making Lala a cake for her birthday, and Heidi and Matthew want a piece if you do.
Heidi, you can't have one. It's got sugar in it. You know what? My birthday's coming up, September 13th. And what I told Lala what I want is a box of sugar frosted flakes, Kellogg's. That's it. Used to have that on the tour bus, me and Ronnie. I told this to you guys once. After the show, you know, we're in the dressing room hanging out. We're having beer, blah, blah, blah. 1-2 in the morning, we get back on the bus. Okay, we got to leave. Sugar frosted flakes. Get the bowl. Get the sugar frosted flakes. And Ronnie wouldn't eat it. He continued drinking beer. But I'm like, oh, yeah, this is good. That's before I had to watch my sugar. So, no, I'm not making her a cake because it's so hot. It's like 90.
Can you make a cake?
I don't, you know, I could do those box cakes. But then she's going to see me making the cake.
Yeah. Hot in this house.
Yeah. Right, it's so hot. You get, you know what? Just a little cupcake with a candle in it. It's good.
That's all I want.
So, you know, she's a very, very easy girl to be around.
Yeah.
There's not many demands or anything like that. Like, you know, after the days of, you didn't make me a cake. What? I'm supposed to make you a cake? You know. I don't cook very good. I can make pancakes.
Cutlets.
What?
Cutlets.
I make chicken cutlets.
Yeah, you make that good.
I can make mashed potatoes. I'm going to get everybody hungry, but on the East Coast, you might have eaten it already. And Heidi, we're playing Kentucky somewhere.
Yeah.
Somewhere. November?
Yeah, sometime in November. It'll come up on Thursday. You'll see it.
Thursday, we're going to put all the dates up.
Yeah.
Last in Line. It'll be on my site. It'll be on this site and all that stuff. And don't forget this 40% off sawtooth equipment. Okay, and we're going to take one last question. I'm really hungry.
I don't know. I'm hungry talking about all that food.
But we're not going for Mexican food because tomorrow's Lala's birthday. We're going to go to eat somewhere. She doesn't know where.
No.
But I thought, you know, In-N-Out, perfect.
I like In-N-Out.
Like $11. get two burgers and two fries and
some milkshake.
And that's $12. All right, one more question.
Any tips for fast rolls on the toms?
Yeah. Got to use your wrists. See? That's it. You got to just practice the stuff. You know, those are like triplets. Practice everything you know. Go around the drums. What I like is this one. These are 16th notes. 1E and a 2E and a 3E and a 4E and a... So I'm just going 1E and a 2E and a 3, right hand, left hand, alternating. And then I just move my stick position like this. So I got snare, tom, tom. Back to the snare. 1E and up. 1E and up. That's it. 1E and up. And when you get them fast... So you got to practice. You can practice, go 1E and a 2E and a 3E and a 4E and a 5E. And then shorten them. 1E and a 2E and a, I'm sorry, 1E and a 2E and a 3E. Until you get them fast. Then you can practice putting the first two notes, 1E, on the toms. Just concentrate, take a day of practice, and try just doing all rolls, you know? All right. So anyway, thanks for joining me. And I guess we'll see you next week. I'll be here next week. I'm going to start to get busy with the band and all that stuff. We got the EP coming out, too, in November. And so I'll see you next week. Be safe. Thanks for joining me. I really appreciate it. I hope you had fun. And you can wish Lala happy birthday tomorrow.
Yay.
Yay. Okay, you guys, take care.